find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh, check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you. Hey guys, it's the AwesomeCast. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitters here. And this is a happy holidays. This is one of the specials we're doing here out of format. We're not doing the usual podcast Tuesday nights, which hopefully means you're getting this a little earlier than you usually do in the week. And so you can get all your podcasting in before whatever holiday, wherever this ends up in the timeline, whatever the case may be. We're hoping you're having a happy one and not getting in too much trouble out there. But I got a special one. I've been trying to track this down for a while so we can have a real deep sit-down throwdown about podcasting. He joined me several months ago on the evening with PodCamp recording that we did for Podcast Day. That was September, wasn't it? He's Buzzy Torek. He's with the Epicast Network, live from Work Hard Pittsburgh, Epicast Central down there.
What's up? How are you guys?
How you doing, man? We finally got you locked down. And even like you're like amidst also recording other podcasts at this point, yes. Right?
People behind me. Yeah. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
Luckily, I don't have many responsibility for it. I can sit back and let them do their thing.
You're just a supervisor. See, we'll get into this, but you figured this out. You figured this out. Like, I just supervise a podcast. I'm not deep into it. I'm not ever on every episode or anything like that, right?
Yep. It's nice. I can just go get a coffee, run up. As long as nothing catastrophically breaks, we're good.
There you go. So tell me, for those for the uninitiated, tell me what is the Epicast Network generally? What are you guys doing over there?
We are a podcast network / digital content network. We have a bunch of comedy based shows. We have one history show that's still has some comedy in it. A couple West Coast health shows, and we're getting into doing more and more video, setting up, live comedy shows, live streaming and stuff like that. So we do a lot of stuff. We get our hands in a bunch of stuff, and keeping a good focus is hard with as much of the stuff we're involved with,
but that's one thing. We're both kind of in the midst of doing podcast networks. So we had Frank Mergy, which both of us have had conversations with of Pittsburgh Podcast Network, and just the amount of people involved. I don't even know how many people are involved with you. I see new faces every time I look at your website. It seems like
it's cool. We just started doing the millennials now, which is like skit comedy, and we're up to, I think there was 15 people here just writing,
wow.
15 people coming together, bringing scripts, throwing ideas off each other. And it's cool. It's a cool thing to see.
We've had something similar happening with Sawtooth Willie, because we will come down. It's just me on the camera. It's Will doing he's kind of doing an improv with this character. And we pull together the videos from that. But people keep wanting to come over to watch us filming it. And it's just, it's just like a closet in my basement that looks dungy, so we stuck them in there. And then a bunch of people just gathered around watching this thing, and they will periscope it, and everybody's like all about it, like seeing the process and everything,
Having like when we do filming, sometimes we encourage people to come watch, because having an audience actually turns people on a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Certainly. That's kind of my thing. I know, like this, we're able to catch you on Hangout. But you guys, for the most part, your shows are in person, face-to-face. Especially the Does This Holds Up, the Drinking Partners. You're very more local Pittsburgh based, I think, than anything, right?
Yeah, most of our shows are Pittsburgh based, but we don't limit ourselves to that. We're from Pittsburgh for sure. We love everything Pittsburgh represents, and happy to be here. But there's a lot of cool stuff going on outside of the city.
Awesome. I gotta bring up. So we both had a thread that both of us have recently been involved in some fashion with a podcast that involved the mayor of Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
And I think that's important to bring up, considering this is the year where Mark Maron, in his own way, put podcasting on the map with the president of the United States. Now, we had the Pittsburgh-based version of this.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay. We're just like, it's happening, man.
Yeah.
and I wasn't part of the planning process. I was actually simply the engineer on a live podcast during a light up night, which was insane to begin with, in the middle of Fifth Avenue. You guys had the nice controlled environment of his office, at least for drinking partners, right?
Yep. Yeah. I think Peduto, the mayor of Pittsburgh, he gets it. And, I think he realizes the value that we bring to the table and candid conversation. And, it's cool to have, you know, someone sit down for an hour and shoot the shit with you and be real. You know, I don't think you don't see much politicians doing that, but, that's what's cool about podcasting. We get an honest conversation. There's nothing to hide from, you know, when you're behind the mic. So.
No. And I'm constantly surprised at how candid he is. I noticed the bike lanes got brought up in both these conversations.
We have a meeting because of that. We're scheduled to go with Bike Pittsburgh soon. So our guys did a good job of pissing off the whole bike scene in here. So.
Right. But just making a joke. That's fine. But hey, when you put yourself in that political space, that's kind of a whole new can of worms.
Yeah, for sure.
All right. So I mean, I think it's really interesting. You know, I think you're seeing this as well. Some of you guys involved in stuff. There's a lot of. I made a big tweet yesterday about how because I was in conversations with one of you guys from over at Does This Hold Up about something coming up this year. Of course, PodCamp we do every year, and I'm hearing about podcast incubators. I'm hearing about these other events in the works. There's actually a 24-hour podcast idea I've been floating around. That actually became Chachi Plays for Kids several years ago when I first thought of it, but I'm moving that on to somebody else to kind of work on here. I said 2016 is going to be a big year for podcasting, especially in the area here.
For sure.
I mean, it feels like, you know, one, everybody step in and say, should I be doing a podcast? Or the horrible question I always hear. So how do I make money from a podcast? Which is you're in trouble to begin with. Good luck. Yeah, exactly.
Hire 10 people, you know, write a script for 6 months at a time, and then get someone investing in you before you do it. It's the only way to make money from it, I think.
Get an investor, be able to buy all the Facebook ads you possibly can. Yeah. You know, I mean, that's really it. What's that?
You have to dump about $1,000 into Facebook ads to get any, like, easy.
Yeah.
An easy $1,000 to get the play that you need, yeah.
I mean, it would grow exponentially from that, and I could see that happening. But really, the advertising model, I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't know anybody locally that's got that locked down right now.
We shouldn't have to pay Facebook for people to see what we're doing. That's mm-hmm. It's bullcrap. Mm-hmm. You know, we all are creatives, and we're all, you know, working hard to do things. And the fact that for anybody on that social platform to see what we do, we need to pay them.
Right. It, they gave it to us. They helped us build us up. I feel bad for the people that made Facebook their website. Like their .com directs to their Facebook / website. And I think that's a general problem. But I mean, hey, at least we still got Twitter, right?
Yep.
For now.
Yeah, for sure.
For now. but certainly. It really is about getting that exposure out there. And I think you guys do something interesting. And I got to be honest, I'm jealous of how much you guys get out there in the meat space with your shows, because that's something I've never been able to figure out. But you guys get out there and do these comedy shows and are able to build events, and especially that local push around these things. I attended the Does This Hold Up 100th episode, which I just saw you guys tweeting and sharing over the Star Wars celebration. That's some good synergy right there.
Yeah, for sure. We got random retweets and tons of engagement for a little, you know, we played off the hashtag as mm-hmm. we should, and it mm-hmm. was Throwback Thursday, so everything worked out.
There you go.
But yeah, it's, you know what, it's actually hard to get people to come out for live podcasts. We haven't had any luck. You know, we do the drinking partner shows, and some people come out, and Does This Hold Up did, you know, great live. Marta did a great live show. Mm-hmm. But in general, it's, I don't think people around here, comparatively, when you look at other markets, I don't think people know what podcasts are around here. You know, people definitely do, but, you know, out of 10, how many people are listening to podcasts in Pittsburgh? Maybe 3, 4? Or you go to the West Coast and you're looking at, you know, 8, 9 out of 10. Like everybody listens. So
well, it's also hard. It's hard to simmer that down too, because I can see, like, I don't consider like the wrestling show, for instance, for us, like a Pittsburgh podcast. There's a lot of Pittsburghers on it, but we have co-hosts and we talk about wrestling or involved with wrestling with people from Texas, from New York, from California now. And so I really, and I've always battled with, do I do a local thing, meetup, live show, whatever, because where are most of my fans? I think most of them are in Pittsburgh, yes. But I think that still ends up being a handful that will actually come. It's hard to get people out. At PodCamp, Chris Brogan was there and says, listen, most of you guys are creatives and you don't like leaving the house anyways. Mm-hmm. You're here. Good job. You made it. Yeah, you know what I mean? I mean, a lot of us get in front of the microphone.
And that's a free event.
Yeah.
You know, the event you guys do, it's free education.
Right.
And you can learn a lot there, and it's hard to get people out. It's hard to get people to engage. It is. Especially, I don't know, Pittsburgh, we're in a good spot for engagement with art, I think. It's just getting what we do on people's radar. I think that's a lot of it. And people that are into it are without a doubt into it. You know, we have Does This Hold Up has a fanboy cult following, you know, that lots of people locally like love what they do. And there's, you know, different drinking partners. It's weird. They do better in California than they do PA with downloads.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, we've only had, you know, Pittsburgh breweries on. So it's neat, though. It's cool to see what markets we're getting into.
Mm-hmm.
And even though they're like a local Pittsburgh podcast, they still do well outside of the city. So
that's interesting. There's actually a conversation I engaged with on Facebook today. There's a wrestling podcast called We Watch Wrestling. It's from you know, some of the guys, I think it's with Earwolf or something like that, one of the bigger comedy networks. And they're talking about how they deep dive in this thing where they talk about like the local pro wrestling, guerrilla wrestling, which is like, it's amazing. Celebrities come to this thing, but it's in this like small bingo hall thing that's packed, but it's like the most mind blowing wrestling ever. And everybody's talking about it. And they're sitting down and talking about the show. And it reminded me back in the day when we would just talk about this Fed in Pittsburgh. Right. And we're like, nobody else cares. Like they're here to hear us talk about John Cena and stuff, right? And I just saw like somebody's like, I don't think I want to listen to this because I don't care about their local Fed I can't go to or buy their DVDs of. And but I think that's an interesting, like, well, we have access to the local thing, like you guys with the breweries, right? But still, I'm kind of interested to see, like, well, what's your show like over there? What do you guys have over there? I'm not in that place. And getting that kind of personalized, localized thought process, right?
For sure. I think that's what's cool about podcasts. You get in the niche. You get, like, in the know. There's no hiding behind anything when you're, you know, one-on-one with someone for an hour. You know, I think that's huge. You get to learn a lot about people and cities and where they're from and what they do and, you know, what's cool there and... Yeah.
Have you been listening to Serial?
Nope.
Dude, I have never listened to an episode of Serial. I gotta be honest.
I haven't been eating cereal either. Might not look like it, but.
No. I don't believe in morning food. Except for bacon, right?
Yeah, sure.
Exactly. This is the conversation because I have every app that does, even Pandora is popping up and saying, "Are you listening to Serial? We got the first episode for you. Don't worry about it." I'm like, "Oh, that's okay, Pandora. You don't worry about it." But I mean, you do have to appreciate at least like it's a broader conversation a lot. But I don't know. I think we talked about this a little bit before. What do you think about this now? It's kind of popped back up in our faces as podcasters again. Like, oh, hey, podcasting's not dead again.
Yeah. I don't know. If it's bringing more listeners, then good. I'm seeing a lot of people are into the big production shows, and I know Serial is one of them. I think they said they went into pre-production for what, a year and a half or something.
Wow.
For the first one. This did, like, that's, you know, you got people spending hundreds of thousands of dollars on writing and making sure things are exactly the right way.
Right,
and
right.
I think it's paying off. I mean, look what's going on. Look at with Startup. You know how much you could listen to Startup and immediately realize how much, you know, effort has went into it before they started. So I don't know. I kind of want to take my swipe at one of those big production shows. Obviously, we would do it with, you know, minimal effort, maximum return, because that's
exactly
how I like to run lean and mean anyway. But
That's kind of been for me when like we started podcasting. You know, obviously, you know, you came from audio background. We haven't talked about this on here. You come from an audio background. I mean, you helped put together your studio down there at Work Hard, and me more from a video background. We're reminiscing on the 500th episode about like back when we had like we like kind of were passing around a $15 PC mic from Radio Shack to start with, and that was it,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And rolling it out on Shoutcast that was sitting in a tower beside me in there on an old Comcast connection. You know, this is 10 years ago. So we had a max of 10 listeners, right?
Yeah.
And building up through that, but it's always been about the conversation for at least on my end. And it was always for me, the antithesis of that slick, well-produced radio thing. And I've been on a couple of radio interviews and kind of hear how those go and realizing the feeling and realizing like, I don't feel like I had time to get anything real out there, right?
Yeah.
It is that talking in sound bites you have to be. Even on TV, you know, it's like, really, I only have a half an hour to talk to you with breaks? Really? You know, it feels so constricted versus, you know, we've had interviews gone from 15 minutes to an hour and a half because it's like, dude, just keep telling me stories about the road. You know, some of these wrestlers out there. And it's beautiful.
That's what people are always coming to me asking, what's the best time for a podcast? It's like, seems to be the newest question that everybody asks. What's the best, you know, podcast length? It's just like, it's all dependent on show. You know, it depends on what you're doing. But if you're getting into an hour conversation and it's going really good, like, why would you put a cap on that? You know, if it's lightning and your show is not, you know, a strict half hour every time, it doesn't matter. Like, enjoy yourself, enjoy the conversation. If it's good, it's good. You know, you'll know when it's time to cut it off, you know. Yeah, it's getting annoying hearing that question so much.
I mean, the commuter question is usually what I ask. Like, you know, that's who you're picking up, because who's going to find time? Because we're also competing with video games. We're competing with, you know, TV, whatever TV people are still watching, YouTube now, and Netflix, all that kind of stuff. And I know for me, it's like, okay, X is happening. That means I can throw a podcast on in the background. You know, you go into a mode of like, here's the list of things I can do when I'm sitting at a computer doing this. I can throw some music on while I'm working, you know, or I'm in a car, I can do these things. And then, you know, even I'm like, now I'm trying to find time to play with my Google Cardboard. Because if I'm home, I'm with my wife and I'm watching TV, and she gets annoyed when I start tinkering with that thing and put it on my face. And so, you know, you're just like, what's that?
Got one here at the studio. There's one upstairs. Someone got one shipped from like Mini, and I put my phone in it and was playing with it for like 2 hours last night.
It's great. It's great. I was doing all the Star Wars stuff last night. It's just like me wandering. I make sure I turn the TV on so I like know where things are in my living room with the thing on my face, so I'm not tripping over the coffee table or anything like that. And then like I the great thing is I take it off and realize how far I wandered. but that's the thing. It's like you need to block out that time, and your podcast has to be either the right time for the people that you want, or, you know, that good that they really want to find the time for them to bring it up. I mean, there's plenty of shows that are like, these are the ones I listen to every week. And then when I'm like, I just need something fun and extra. And that's where like a Nerdist or a Does This Hold Up comes up for me. You know what I mean? Like, that's where that space is out, versus the tech news thing I got to hear today. This thing I got to hear today, you know, it's Tuesday. It's time for Matt, you know, this show, you know, which also that kind of goes to the consistency side too.
Yeah, for sure. That's what the more content you put out there, sometimes that it gets lost because people have so much, you know, other shit to do. That's it's a challenge. But I'm a fan of short podcasts and long podcasts. I really like Does This Hold Up because it's so tight and it's bam 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 done.
Oh,
and they're
so
out
great.
Within a half hour usually, and that's nice. It's refreshing. But you know, we have Ed and Dave from the Drinking Partners get on and start, you know, talking to someone, and we're, you know, an hour and 45 minutes in, and we're like, let's go, come on, like, let's go, like, wrap it
somebody
up.
Somebody has a studio after us, let's go.
yeah, for sure.
That's great. Even for like most of my like client ones that I've started lately, I've been like targeting 15 minutes, mostly because I don't know if the person can go more than 15 minutes, you know, to stretch that out. Sometimes the subject matter, because, you know, we're usually talking about in my case, a lot of times, like health and mindfulness and stuff. And I feel like an hour is far too long. You need tidbits. You know what I mean? Because you need to, we're convincing people to do these things, you know, versus this is just, you're already a tech fan. You're already a wrestling fan. You're already a, you know, a movie fan for some of your guys or what. It's like, this is my space, you know, versus we're trying to pull the people in a little bit too. So I guess it depends. I know you do some shows. You also do some shows around clients and stuff. We this is kind of the interesting advent that it's a podcast business, and some of us have kind of plans around that. How are you, as much as you're willing to disclose, of course, what is your kind of strategy when somebody comes to you like, hey, I want to do a podcast for X, you know?
First, I try to learn their demographic, like who is this going to appeal to? Then I try to let them realize that this is a big job and there's so much work. There's an endless amount of work behind podcasting. I mean, you know, between scheduling tweets, getting graphics, photos are huge. We're looking at photos in our analytics. Like when we have a photo to push with our podcast, it goes almost double, double the rate. Sending out emails, looking for sponsors, you know, people, you got to do a show for a year to get good at it. And then you got to have, you know, once you're good at it, you got to do it long enough to have, you know, dedicated listeners so you can get money back from what you're doing. And it's hard to get money back for what you're doing unless you're doing it 100% and you're scheduling 3 tweets a day, no matter what. And you're, you know, interactive with your fans and you have a good focus, and it's challenging. There's everybody can do it right now. So it's you against the world.
Yeah.
You know, how do you beat that? How do you market it? You know, there's so much that goes into it. People don't realize that, you know, they think that it's recording and throwing stuff up, but you're ID3 tagging and writing podcast descriptions that are catchy. And then you're tweeting it. And do you add a photo or do you not add a photo? Because when you add a photo, you can tag people. But when you don't add a photo, as a podcast player, so there's
and then Facebook changes everything anyways, and you have to learn the new way in a couple of weeks, right?
Yep, for sure.
That's the worst feeling. I go in to help a client with these kinds of things on Mondays, and then that, you know, getting down, setting in, and be like, oh, what did Facebook just do?
Yeah, we should organize a podcast Facebook strike. That's due coming up soon.
Yeah, but how many of us are actually sinking money into Facebook? We're all low budget productions trying to work around what they're giving us, right?
I know, but people ask me, you know, what can I do to get, you know, to get my show more listens? And I'm just like, you can add Twitter followers, which is a slow grind that that helps, but pay for Facebook ads is my next suggestion, because it's what you got to do. And it's annoying.
As I know, we've had the conversation, Katie from this show, she actually got to attend something awesome with Facebook, and she's like, she just came back, she's like, we are completely doing Facebook wrong, holy crap.
Yeah, it seems like they're getting into a lot of video focus now.
Oh yeah,
if which is their video players are changing over, and they're trying to mimic YouTube, it seems.
Mm-hmm. And if you're already doing bite-sized stuff, like the Sawtooth Willy stuff does, like, exponentially.
Yeah, that's what I was just going to say. Like, even if you have a podcast, if you have video, cut it up. And even if you don't have video, just put your logo and cut up, like, you know, 2-minute clips that are funny from your show. Link that right back to your podcast. I mean, you don't see Epicast doing that much because we have 18 shows and not enough time to cut that up. But, you know, that's my suggestion for podcasters is, you know, cut your stuff up, put it on Clamor, put little clips on YouTube all the time, and you can create content out of the content that already exists that's more consumable for your fan base.
Exactly, or discoverable by new fans, right?
Yeah,
I mean, that's a big thing, especially the YouTube, especially I think Facebook is getting in this, where it's that engagement. We don't really, and depending on where you're at, what platform you're on, you don't really get to see the engagement with podcasts because it's really just not there yet. Like the podcast gets downloaded and that's all you can see for the most part.
Yeah, the analytics are kind of junk right now.
Yeah, and it's kind of a functional problem of the platform. But when you're doing something for Facebook or YouTube, you want people to be able to watch most of that video and stick around for most of that video. And that's going to kick in that algorithm, and more people are going to want to show that video to more people to keep them on their sites watching video, right? And watching ads and stuff like that. So you're helping them out, you get your things shown more. And that's why I have debates like, do I just cut these segments down to, like, sometimes we'll talk about a subject on wrestling for like 15 minutes. And I'm like, well, maybe I'll just put the first 3 minutes and just say, hey, go check out the rest of the show. But then now I'm back to, you know what, I'm just going to put the whole 20 minutes on there because I kind of want them to have, like, I want the person that watches it to have the entire segment at least, right?
Yeah,
And I know, especially the controversial ones, they've been, that actually worked really well. Not a lot of positive contents, but it's comments, but it's YouTube, right?
Yeah.
I'm getting comments, period. I'm good to go. So getting that engagement, whether it's positive or negative. At least there's a debate over it, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Especially wrestling. These fans, holy crap.
Yeah, I'd imagine that's a heavy trolled universe, maybe.
Oh, yeah. that in movies for you guys would probably be good, too. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's got to be a heavily...
I think Sean does a really good job at outsmarting people, and the guys from Buzz's Hold Up can do. Yeah, they can handle their own for sure.
Mm-hmm.
They would just make fun of anyone, you know, anybody that would try to make fun of them. They would just get back.
Yeah. We have a pretty good. I'm not the guy to do that. So I just like guys. Like I'll see something pop up, and I'll just email the rest of the guys on the list. And be like, have fun if you want. Go at it. Yeah. Sure.
Screenshot it and just put shots fired.
Yeah, shots fired. Just have fun with it. You know what I mean? And sometimes I don't want to chase and it's always interesting if you're somebody that's kind of dealing with comments like this for the first time. It is curious sometimes where like somebody will say something crappy and you'll respond. You're like, "Oh yeah, we actually meant this, but thanks, you know, for the comment regardless of how nasty it was." We've had people trolling us on Twitter that have come back and now I know our regular listeners to the show interact with us.
Yeah,
that started as awesome. The worst trolls. And I think we actually got one of their Twitter accounts suspended. And they came back around. They're like, oh, wait, maybe this is...
Another fans.
Yeah, now they're fans. Yeah. You know, it's a potential fan. What is the thing? One fan at a time, right? And even if you can turn that around and be like, oh, you know, it depends. If their motivations is just really to burn everything down, as most trolls are, no, you're not getting anything. But you can, you know... You can kind of play with that a little bit. So, I guess, we had this conversation before. You know, okay, it is easy to have a podcast these days. There's apps that you hit a button and you do it. Somebody sent me a sample on their phone, and I think they put it in a Windows Movie Maker or something, which really confused me when I got WMV on my Mac. I was like, oh, what do I do with this again? But other than that, It's probably the hardest now to get any traction than it did. Because we've had conversations again, you know, thinking back to when we started the wrestling things, which were kind of hit a milestone here recently. Like how many of those guys came up to us and says, yeah, I went to this site, looked up wrestling podcasts, and there was you. Period. You know, and me and one other guy. And now I know I'm competing with you put in wrestling podcasts. Stone Cold Steve Austin has something. Chris Jericho has something, you know.
Mick Foley.
Mick Foley. I don't think he's a podcast yet, although he should.
He's done, I think, Mark Maron and Burke Kreischer.
Oh, I got to go find that one. I got to go find the Mark Maron one. But, you know, now you really have to have your niche. to have a wrestling podcast, have a movie podcast, have a technology podcast.
And you need your niche and you need a marketing degree, I think. Like it's impossible.
Well, isn't that interesting that it seems like we're all of us are kind of in process of getting our marketing degrees as we're figuring out Twitter and stuff. And then I don't remember the point was when I was like, oh, I'm a guy that does Twitter things. I'm doing social media things. And I'm like, oh crap, I'm a marketer.
Yeah.
You know, really in the long run. Yeah.
And that's, you know, that's what I was saying. There's a lot to be learned with, like when you add photos or, you know, that's like, you got to be strategic about things. Like I waited for the Star Wars tweet for the day that Star Wars came out, you know, and I waited for Throwback Thursday for it. So there's two hashtags that you can play off of that, you know, are heavier that day than any other day of that week. So it's just, sometimes it's a waiting game. Sometimes it's just being strategic and learning best practices for that kind of stuff. And who's to say who's right? I guess the answers in your numbers and analytics. But yeah, it's a challenge. I'm always learning more. I'm always trying to teach people. Never mind what I told you last week. Let's try it this way. So
I think the other discouraging thing is, and I'm finding this with because I usually kind of move in the properties that kind of have a fan base already, and like I'm hitting one where I'm like, I don't know where these people are. I'm still trying to figure it out with these guys, right? And for somebody starting a podcast, I think it can be discouraging when they're like, well, I'm out and I'm tweeting, nobody's finding me. You know, you got to do it for a while. You got to put the time in. You know, this is I think I've talked about before the 10 episode rule, right? When you talk about a year to get good, I think 10 episodes is enough to at least know what direction you're going in and know how this microphone thing works and doing that whole thing. I also do not recommend anybody doing a video podcast. I know. We're on a video podcast, but man, the numbers are not good for the video part of this. It's more just kind of for fun. And so we have it for clips and it looks cool. But the audio, it's all about the audio people. And starting off, you don't need to know, okay, I got to figure out how the microphone works, plus how the camera works, plus I want to live stream on YouTube. You know, that is a lot of stuff to get started.
That's a lot.
And if you're already somebody trying to figure out, you know, if this is something you want to do and you add all those numbers, like, geez, that's a little much.
Start with audio. I mean, it doesn't hurt to have video for, you know, clips in the future, but it depends on where you're at. It seems like, focusing on getting good traction right off the bat is the best thing to do. Like trying to hit iTunes new and noteworthy, trying to have a ton of content to launch with. We're learning before we would tell people, you know, we want to launch with 4 podcasts and we want to go, but now it's like, I want to see you put out some kind of audio, data, some kind of audio file to your fans 3 times a week when you're on new and noteworthy. And I think that, little tip for anybody starting that, like store some shows up, and when you launch with iTunes, throw them out at least twice a week. And I think that will help a lot of people get a lot more plays, because I think half of the iTunes algorithms or whatever they're measuring, I think new content helps. So every time we release something, we get a big bump up in the positive, you know, in the positive direction.
When we're
featured there, and I just think the more you put out in that time, the better you will go. So you can get 40,000 plays an episode if you do it right. You know, you just have to have a good show. You have to launch it right. You have to do the time and consult a professional like me or Sword.
There you go. Wow, that turned into a plug.
I think it's true, though. I think that, like, me and you know a lot. There's so much to know about this kind of stuff. And, you know, a lot of people just start a podcast and don't have any research or any plan of attack. And I think, you know, that's why there are networks. That's why there are people that have been doing this.
Maybe all they heard was Serial.
Yeah.
With this podcasting thing.
Exactly.
Yeah. And that's the other thing.
And so many people tell me, you know, I want a podcast. It's like, go ahead, try, you know, record one into your phone, try it out. No one even tries it. They expect it to be some easy thing, and they don't realize how much goes into it, you know?
And the biggest thing, the biggest thing I've been trying to get out there is, I'm not going to go make a podcast and make money from the podcast. The podcast has to be just like your Twitter account. You're not making money from your Twitter account. It helps you sell the thing you're actually going to sell, right?
Yeah. So
I mean, for me, these podcasts are a conversation piece, a place to talk to people, you know, like you, and kind of build that network and help share, hey, here's cool people, and build that. Mm-hmm. And also, it's kind of a showpiece for all the other things that we have going on. If you're, the podcast we do for a mental health practice, it's not something that's going to ever do crazy numbers, because all they really need are people that come in that door understanding what's going on inside those doors.
Yeah, and so it's more of a support for their brand.
It is.
It's content for that all goes back to the bigger picture, right?
Exactly.
And that you can do a podcast that takes off and you get, you know, big traction and big plays, but that's a long shot. That's like getting signed to a record label when you're in a band. I see a lot of people a lot of companies that come to me. You have to realize this is still more support for your bigger picture. So you're a consultant in real estate or you're, you know, a health and fitness coach, either way, you know, your podcasts are only going to support what you preach and practice in your field. And they're not going to blow up. I mean, they could blow up, but you shouldn't have that expectation.
No, not on that side of things, right? a lot of comedians do podcasts, you know, and I'm sure a lot have dreams of being Mark Maron, you know, that does like a bunch of ads at the beginning of his thing. And now, like, I think he just partner with somebody that for a subscription service so you can go check out his back catalog.
Oh, he's always done that. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
it's only like a dollar or something, but I can't imagine the.
Oh, that's right. He actually migrated it to a whole other service because he was doing it himself. So now it's part of a grander subscription fee of, and you get a bunch of other stuff. I forget what it was. But you know, in the meantime, like I've had this conversation with some actually mutual friends of ours about, you know, no, this is so you get people to see who you are, you know, and hopefully they'll, you know, that will help, you know, for comedians, you know, they saw you on stage. Hey, I got a podcast. If you like what this guy does, go check it out. Like it's that extra bit. Right. It kind of expands the world. It's behind the scenes sometimes. And I think that's really important for something like that, you know. I'm always iffy on the ones that like directly sell something, like the Entrepreneurs on Fire ones and things like that. Like
yeah, I think that guy claims he's making a ton of money. I don't know.
I believe he is. Like there's a certain angle on there, and I was actually on one of these Harness the Web, actually, a guy out of Beaver, I think his name is Steve Peck, if I recall. I just saw it yesterday. A really cool guy, and he's kind of doing that, selling a service over here about making it on LinkedIn or something like that. Good for them. They're sellers. Chris Brogan does something very similar with the Owner's Mind stuff, and it feels the least icky to me. It's the only word I can come up with. Something I don't want to trash these things, but I know
where you're coming from.
Yeah. It's just like
corporate, almost
not corporate.
You know, it's me. Like I know where you're going.
And I try to, and I feel like my personal one, the basics ergonomics one. I'm like, we talk about concepts that I'm working around. But then, like, I'm like, oh, we have a webinar we're trying to do. You know, it's like, I can't sell the thing, you know. But that's supposed to be where that's supposed to move towards. But I want to happen as naturally as possible. But yeah. I'm just not a great salesman. I'm a great salesman on the things I believe in. But I can't sell you on the thing that will make me money. So, it's always my issue. So, but we're figuring that out. And mailing lists and all that stuff that people tell me I should be doing.
Me too. We need to do that.
Give something for free. Although give something for free is huge. And that's like when you're like, well, I'm already giving away free podcasts. What is that extra thing I do? I just kind of moved my stuff into retail. We give away wrestling shows now. So, and now that I've done the webinars, I'm going to give away a webinar for about podcasting, actually. So to help that out. I mean, that's the biggest thing. You got to figure out, like, what is the thing that we can provide that we want your email address? What is worth it to you to give us your email address for this X? You know what I mean? And that's really hard to figure out when you're not, like, specifically selling something, I guess.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, I just kind of developed into, like, a whole other world in order to be able to facilitate that, so... what else podcasting wise, like what else is on your mind? What do you think people need to know about what's going on out there today?
There's something coming next year that I can't talk about much.
Uh-oh.
I can't talk about who's doing it.
Uh-oh.
But I do know there will be a 2016, it's 2015 right now, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm pretty sure.
Yes.
I'm pretty sure.
I don't 2016 Pittsburgh Podcast Festival. Ooh. So, That'll be a thing. It already is a thing, and there's a lot of people behind it working hard on it. So, I'm stoked for that. You will be involved. I'm sure.
I think I just became involved yesterday. I'm of some sort. I got a message from a mysterious source.
Nice.
So, <Yeah. laughs> from a mutual mysterious source, which is fantastic.
Because if anyone has 10 grand, 10 to 15 grand, so we can to help out on that idea, let me know. I'll put you through with awesome. The right people to give that money to.
Well, so your guys, I don't know if you went down with them, but I know, does this hold up to the DC PodFest?
Yeah. And they won Best Podcast, Independent Podcast Award. So
that's awesome. So, I mean, it looks like it's kind of a comedy weekend into podcast kind of thing.
Epicast is comedy focused, but we I think that we're going to get the most traction doing live shows with a comedy focus.
Of course.
So if you look at the top 10 podcasts, you know, it's all comedy.
Right.
Most
right.
of it. So we're going to try to pull that off, get a lot, you know, get a couple of the top 10s here in the city. I'd also like to do, you know, educational kind of things. I don't know if we're going to do that like in the city or if we want to do that, you know, classes somewhere else. But I'm sure between, you know, Epicast and you guys and, mm-hmm. and you know, Pittsburgh Podcast Network, I'd imagine we'd have an awesome pool of educational events. I hope we're just throwing around those ideas. But we want to be able to live stream this. People nationally can buy tickets online and, you know, view in everything we're doing. We want a few venues, not just one venue. We want multiple days. So
there's a lot of great, places, even just over in the cultural district between Arcade Comedy Theater. I imagine Brick Lodge would be a good spot for something like this too.
Yep.
You know,
that's what we're looking at. Yeah.
Yeah.
We're looking at running out of building down there and doing something on each floor too. So
it's like, it is awesome what's happened there on that 900 block. I think I got that right from on Liberty Avenue. Like all those places that popped up. It used to be just porn stores. You know,
it's cool. It's the city. It's like a ghost town sometimes. You know, after you know 7-8 o'clock down there. But that whole spread down there is doing a really good job of bringing you know local arts up, and you know even. We host a comedy show with the Drinking Partners down there, and the reason it does well is because it's downtown, you know, mm-hmm. and then people are around and getting out of work and stick around and catch happy hour, then come see a comedy show, which is cool. There's a built-in fan base that is different every time because there's so many people visiting the city, but it's throw an event down there, you're going to have people, you know, interested in what you're doing, which is cool.
If you ever find a venue down there that looks like it's big enough to hold a wrestling ring, I've been really trying to get these guys to get into the city because I really think they'd do well if we got some good venues in the city. But, you know. But maybe we'll just get a warehouse in the Strip District or something like that. I don't know.
Yeah, there's a warehouse up the road from the hardware store.
Yeah, there's that. You know what? I looked at that. I'm like, man, this would be a great place for a wrestling show.
It would be cool. It
feels like some of the cool places I've seen, like other wrestling. It actually feels like almost the ECW Arena in Philadelphia. Just that wide open space, you know, probably fit about the same people, you know, it'd be interesting. Just not a lot of high places for people to make insane dives off of. So, well, Buzzy, thank you so much for joining us. We finally got you together here on the AwesomeCast, and even more so, we got to just like jam and talk podcasting here for a good 40 minutes or so. Thank you for joining me on this early Saturday. It's early. It's early-ish. Whatever. Nobody's watching this right now. They're going to be seeing this in 2 weeks, you know.
I retweeted. We might got like one or two people.
Yeah, a couple in there.
See the impressions.
We got a couple people popping in there. But thank you so much for that. And epicast.tv, a lot of great stuff, a big variety of stuff. And definitely, if nothing else, sit down and watch, listen, whatever you're able to. I sat down and watched the whole thing. Mayor Bill Peduto on the Drinking Partners.
Wow,
it's an awesome, awesome thing, and I highly recommend. Does this hold up, Professor Buzzkill? I know I've been jamming on here for a little bit here, and good stuff, real good stuff, real quality podcasting quality. It's my new phrase of the year. Which there's a story behind that.
So, great, man. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much, Buzzy. You can check out everything awesomecast.net. SorgatronMedia.com. There'll be a few shows. Again, we're a little light here over the holidays, letting everybody take a little bit of a break. But let's be honest, we're all workaholics anyway, so you'll be getting something going out there. So please subscribe to us over there. And I'm at Sorgatron on the Twitter, at Epicast TV on the Twitter, and anywhere else. What other Twitter should they follow for you?
It's embarrassing to even say the name. It's BIGBUZZUM. Big Buzzum at Twitter is my personal. And Epicast will have a new website. Who knows? I'm going to say next month, but it might be like a year from now before that happens.
Hey,
so,
man.
Soon.
Don't be embarrassed by the Twitter name. I'm the one that turned myself into a transformer practically. So thank you so much. You've been our awesome audience. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at SorgatronMedia.com.